King David talks about in Psalms 23, verse 5. He speaks of God preparing a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. That's a party. He said, listen, God loves me so much that he's going to prepare a party for me in the midst of my enemies. My enemies think harm of me. My enemies want to do me wrong, but God is throwing me apart. Do you remember where Jesus was when he performed his first miracle? John chapter 2, you remember where it was?
Party.
He was at a party. He was at a party. Then in Revelation chapter 19, verse 9, the Bible talks about this, that God is going to be throwing a big, bodacious, giant party in eternity. In the culmination of time, God is going to throw the biggest party that you ever saw. It's called the Marriage Supper of the Lamb. Big old party. If you get to heaven, you're going to experience the ultimate party. Marriage Supper of the Lamb. God loves to party. When Jesus came into this world, he came in part to establish his kingdom. He came to establish his kingdom. In fact, in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, it says, Jesus preached, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near you. Repent. What does repent mean? It means to change your direction. It needs to change your direction. You've been going to one party. It's time to change your direction, for the kingdom of God has come. And did you know, as believers of Jesus, we represent the kingdom of God. We are called to advance the kingdom of God. We are a kingdom church. Everywhere you go, in your work, in your school, at your job, at the mall, as a believer, you're called to represent the kingdom of God. We are kingdom disciples. And in Matthew chapter 22, verse 2, someone asked Jesus to describe the kingdom of God. And you know how Jesus described the kingdom of God? You know what he said? Matthew 22, you know what he said? He said, the kingdom of God is like a party. He said, it's like a party. What a great image. What an awesome image. And some of y'all love the party. You ought to be shouting over this. Listen, in the ancient world, a wedding party was a huge thing. The wedding party usually lasted 3 days, not one day like we do it here. And there was loud singing, there was crazy dancing, there was great excitement. And Jesus said, my kingdom is like a party. It's supposed to be exciting. See, now I know why the devil throws so many parties. Now I understand why there's so many clubs and bars on every street. You know why? You know why? Because the devil is presenting a counterfeit type of kingdom of God. The devil is presenting a counterfeit type of atmosphere to the kingdom of God. He is presenting a perverted experience to the kingdom of God, and he's attracting billions of people. Billions of people. And you know what? The reality is that the church at large, in part, is to blame. You know why? Because we've made church so boring. We've made church so boring. We made church, or following Jesus, so boring. We have taken the power out of the church. And so people come to church and they don't experience Jesus. They don't experience the Holy Spirit. They come and they go as they came, and there ain't no power in the church. And so billions of people are walking away from Jesus because the church has misrepresented the kingdom of God. But I got news for you. Chapel of Change is called to bring the party back to God. We're called to bring the party back to the kingdom of God. We're called to bring the party back. See, hear me today, friends. Get this. The problem is not that you like to party. God loves to party. The problem is you've been going to the wrong party. That's the problem. You hit a wrong turn. And you went to the wrong party, and it's killing you. And it's damaging you. And it's taking away your hope. It's taking away your future. It's taking away your life. We had an awesome Kingsmen dinner last Friday night at our Long Beach campus. And we all gathered, almost filled up the place. And we had a brother give a powerful testimony, Brother R. He gave a powerful testimony. One of the things that stood out to me, what he said. He said, you know what? I was invited to a party at 8 years old and didn't leave until I was 35. Some of y'all get that later. You know, the devil will take you hostage. And that party zaps you of your life. Zaps you of your marriage. Destroys your future. But that's not so in the kingdom of God. God's party gives life. God's party gives hope. God's party gives healing. God's party gives purpose. In fact, Isaiah 25 verse 8, it describes the God's party. It says, the Lord God will wipe tears away from all faces, and he will remove the shame of his people from all the earth. When you go to God's party, he removes the shame from your life. He removes the regret. He removes the pain. He removes the burden that the devil's party has put on your life. The problem is not that you like to party. God loves the party. The problem is we've been tricked into going to the wrong party. We fell for the okey-doke and couldn't get out of it. And some of us are still held captive. But the power of God is here today to set you free. The power of God is here. God's not boring. You're boring. God's not boring. God's not boring at all. Serving the Lord is not boring. It's exciting to be used by God. Here's the second thought I got for you. We are to invite people to God's party. We are to invite people to God's party. You're not to be the only one at God's party. Nor are you to just stand around with your shoulders against the wall like you did in junior high school. You are to invite people to God's party. Verse 17 says, he sent his servant at supper time to say to those who were invited, come, for all things are now ready. Our purpose as disciples is to invite people into God's party. The reason why you're still alive, the reason why you're saved, the reason why God redeemed you is so that you can invite others into this experience of knowing Jesus as their Lord and Savior. I want to put this in your spirit. Found people, find people. Found people, find people. Repeat that with me. Found people, find people. One more time. Found people, find people. This is the reason why you're alive. You are alive today because God wants to use your life to bring other people back to him. We are to invite people to come back to him. In fact, 2 Corinthians 5:20 says, so we are Christ's ambassadors. The moment you accepted Jesus Christ as your life, he anointed you to be an ambassador, to represent the kingdom of God. He says God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead. Come back to God. There's one thing I've learned from being out of prison for 8 years now, going on 9 years in July, is that many of the people in Greater Los Angeles and Greater Long Beach, they know about God because either their mom taught them about God when they were little or their grandma taught them about God, but many of us have fallen away. Many of us have been diverted and we went to the wrong party, but God has risen up Chapel of Change to call Los Angeles back to him. God has risen us up to call back to him. And he wants to use your life. In church, we have a holy responsibility to fulfill the great commission of Jesus Christ. Before he left, in Matthew 28:18, Jesus says, all authority in heaven and earth has been given unto me. Therefore, go. Someone say go.
Go
and make disciples of all nations. That's our marching orders, Chapel of Change. We're not called to just come and have Club Med Christianity. We're not called to just worship this building. We're called to make disciples, to reach this nation for the kingdom of God. That's why you're alive. We're also called to invite people to Sunday celebrations. You're called to invite people to Sunday celebrations. When we gather here on Sundays at 12:30, we don't call that services. We call them celebrations because we come to celebrate Jesus. I said we come to celebrate Jesus. We come to celebrate the King of Kings. We come to celebrate what God is doing in our life. We come to celebrate answered prayer. We come to worship the King. We come to celebrate what God is doing. The Bible says that God wants his house full. As long as there is an empty seat in this place, we have a job to do. And it's exciting to be used by God to call people into his plan.
Amen.
We do a prayer booth every Tuesday in Long Beach on Long Beach Boulevard, and even here on Alondra, where our team sits out in the middle of the street, not the middle, but on the sidewalk, and we give away free prayer. I'm going to show you this picture. We give away free prayer. And last week, this family pulled their car over, and they stepped over, and our team prayed for them. They were going through some trouble, and they asked for prayer. Right there on the middle of the street, we reached out to this family. But that wasn't it. They came back to church last Sunday at our Long Beach campus, and they heard the word that I'm preaching to you today. And at the end of the service, they came to the altar, and they surrendered their life to the Lord. I'm going to show you this picture. This is exciting to be used by God to call a generation back to Him. We have another young leader in our church named Jonathan. He's our youth leader at Long Beach campus, and he works for Uber. He works for Uber, right? And he picked up this lady from downtown Long Beach about a month ago and drove her to Echo Park. And on the journey over there, he had this opportunity to talk to her about Jesus. He began to talk to her about God. And little did he know that God was already working behind the scenes in this lady's life. By the way, let me let you know that in the ancient world, the invite came in two parts. The first part was the invite by the master, who would tell you to RSVP the date to save the date. But the second invite came by the servant, who told you that everything was prepared. You need to understand that He's already been working in their life. He's already been setting something up, and He's just using you to seal the deal. So Jonathan talks to this girl about Jesus on the way from Long Beach to Echo Park. And we didn't know this, but that lady's uncle got baptized at our church 2 weeks ago. And unknowing to us, the story ain't even over yet. Unknowing to us, the uncle calls the girl and says, I want you to come to church. I need you to come experience what God is doing. And so last Sunday, Jonathan goes to church, and he's in the middle of the sanctuary, and guess who he sees walking through the door? He sees the same lady who he talked to Jesus about in the car, and it's not even over yet. At the end of the service, when I gave the altar call on who wants to surrender to the Lord, that lady came to the altar, and she surrendered her life to Jesus Christ. I'm showing you the picture. She surrendered her life to Jesus Christ. That's exciting. Man, if that don't excite you, then the elevator don't go all the way up. But it's exciting to be used by God. I got one more thought for you. Someone say number three. Excuses keep you from God's pardon. Excuses keep you from God's pardon. Verse 18, it says, but they all with one accord begin to make excuses. One made an excuse over his home. He used his home as an excuse. He said he bought a piece of land. Another used his work as an excuse. He said, I just bought some oxen. I can't go. Another one used his family. He says, I just got married. Again, brother's using his wife, right? Don't use your wife. Don't do that.
Amen.
Here's what I want you to get. Excuses are the enemy of our destiny. Excuses are the enemy of our destiny. This is what I want you to get today as I begin to close. That excuses will rob you of what God wants you to do in your life. Excuses will rob you of God's destiny for you. And in 2017, we need to conquer excuses, or excuses will conquer us.
Amen.
In 2017, I want to warn you that every time you get an opportunity from God, I want to warn you right now that there's going to be an excuse right next to that opportunity. You're not going to just get an opportunity. You're going to get an opportunity, and you're going to get an excuse at the same time. And you need to be warned. Which one are you going to choose? Are you going to choose the excuse, or are you going to choose the opportunity? And I want to let you know today that God is not pleased with excuses. In fact, in this story, he got mad. In fact, in this particular time in history, if you rejected the invite of the master or somebody who threw a banquet for you, it was like an act of war. Because you disrespected the invite. Who in their right mind will refuse to go to the party that all reality is millions of people are doing it today. You know why? Because they're coming up with excuses. I can't serve the Lord because I work too many hours. I can't serve the Lord because of my wife. I can't serve the Lord because of my kids. I can't serve the Lord because of this. Excuse. We are the masters at excuses. We are the masters at excuses. And the reality is, we are all guilty. The reality is, all throughout the Bible, excuses have tried to rob people of their destiny. God came to Moses and told Moses, you know what, Moses, I want to use you in a mighty way. And the first thing that Moses did was give him an excuse. He says, please, Lord, I'm not elegant and I talk too slow. Came up with an excuse. But eventually he conquered that excuse. God came to a man by the name of Gideon in Judges chapter 6 and said, Gideon, I want to use your life. I want to use you to help your family. I want to use you to deliver the nation. And the first thing that Gideon says is that I am the least in my entire family. God, you don't want to use me. He came up with an excuse. But eventually he conquered that excuse. What are some of the modern day excuses that we give to God today? What are some of the modern day excuses that you hear in the media today? You know, here's a couple of the ones we hear. I can't do it. I can't help it. Here's the one that we hear in our generation a lot. You've heard this over and over again. Here's an excuse. I was born this way. I was born this way. Here's another excuse. This is just what life threw at me. Have you ever heard somebody say that? This was just the cards that was dealt to me. And they use it as an excuse not to do nothing in their life. If I would have used an excuse that I got a life sentence in prison not to do anything for my life, I would have still been in prison today. When they came to me and said, Brian, why you get, when I was 19 years old, I said, man, you know what? I want to get my GED. I want to get my GED. You know what they told me? They said, why you want to get your GED? You got a life sentence. You can't ever use that GED. And I could have used that as an excuse. You know what? Oh, you're right. Why do I need a GED? It doesn't make sense. I got a life sentence. So many of us are going to be tempted to use an excuse not to be all that God has called us to be, not to fulfill our dreams. And I want to challenge you today. I want to challenge you. 2017 is time to throw away the bag. Someone say, throw away the bag. Throw away the bag. You know what the crazy thing is? The crazy thing is, not all of us, because not all of you were like this, but there were some of you that were like this. When you were out in the world getting high, you sure enough didn't have no excuse not to get higher. Like, you found out a way to get high. You came up with a lot of bright ideas, and you found out a way to get high. You didn't have no excuses when you were out in the world. And now all of a sudden you get saved, and God's calling you to step up, and you have this long list. And God is telling you, throw away the bag. Throw away the bag. Listen, when we stand before God on Judgment Day, at the end of eternity, and you stand before God on Judgment Day, and you say, God, I couldn't serve you because I had too much going on in my home. You know what he's going to say? He's going to say, I blessed you with that home. I blessed you with that home. When you stand before God and you say, God, I couldn't serve you because I just had too many kids. I couldn't serve you because I had too many kids. You know what he's going to say? I blessed you with them kids. I blessed you with them kids. Don't pray for rain and then use the rain as an excuse not to go to church. Church, God is saying, throw away the bag. Throw away the bag. God has prepared something for you. Listen, God has prepared something amazing for your life in this world and even something better in the world to come. He has prepared something for you, and he has released us, Chapel of Change, to let you know that God has prepared something special for you that is going to blow your mind away, that is going to blow your neighbor's mind away, that is going to blow your parents' mind away, that is going to blow you away. He has prepared something special for you. Don't let an excuse rob you of what God has for you. Don't let an excuse rob you of your destiny. God is preparing something for you. Let's bow our heads.